Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present Roosevelt and Stalin, Portrait of a Partnership by Susan Butler. Narrated by George Guidall.
To the 405,000 Americans and the 27 million Russians who died in World War II. Chapter 1. Crossing the Atlantic in Wartime. On Thursday morning, November 11, 1943, the 25th anniversary of the armistice that ended World War I, President Roosevelt left the White House in an open convertible and swept through the Capitol, the stars and stripes and the presidential flag flying from the front of the car. He was on his way to pay homage at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier at Arlington National Cemetery. There was a holiday air in the city. Flags were on display, and banks were closed for the day. As the president's car reached the cemetery and proceeded to the tomb, a 21-gun salute, fired from the latest anti-tank guns, boomed out across the Potomac Valley. At 11 o'clock, the exact hour the armistice had been signed, Roosevelt stood bareheaded between General Edwin Pa Watson, his military aide, and Vice Admiral Wilson Brown, his naval aide, in front of the tomb. The day was chilly and raw, the trees almost bare, there was a cold wind. Over the president's shoulders was the dark navy dress cape he frequently wore on short trips from the White House. An army bugler flanked the group on one side, a soldier holding a big wreath of yellow and russet chrysanthemums stood on the other. An army band struck up the Star-Spangled Banner, after which there was the customary moment of silence. Admiral Brown then took the wreath and laid it on the tomb for the president. Four ruffles of muffled drums were heard, and the bugler blew taps. Following the brief ceremony, the sounds of a second 21-gun salute boomed out across the valley as the president's car wound its way out of the cemetery. The House of Representatives marked the day with commemorative speeches, most of which voiced the sentiment that ways must be found to make the coming peace more durable than the last. The Senate was not in session. Roosevelt was in the 10th year of his presidency, the country almost 2 years into World War II. As darkness fell and rain started, the president again left the White House by car, but unlike in the morning, he slipped out unobtrusively. He was on his way to the Marine base at Quantico, Virginia, where the USS Potomac, the sleek white 165-foot presidential yacht, a Coast Guard cutter to which an upper deck and a cabin had been added, awaited. It would take him on the first leg of the 17,442-mile trip through submarine-infested waters to Tehran, Iran, more than halfway around the world. There, for the first time, he would meet Joseph Stalin, the supreme leader of the Soviet Union, the renegade. It would be a momentous occasion for both of them and for the world. With Roosevelt was his closest advisor, Harry Hopkins, in charge of the Lend-Lease program, providing the massive aid flowing to the Soviet Union, his chief of staff, Admiral William Leahy, his personal physician, Vice Admiral Dr. Ross McIntyre, Admiral Brown, General Watson, and his physical therapist, Lieutenant Commander George Fox. The president's car arrived at a dark, seemingly deserted dock far away from intrusive eyes, where the Potomac awaited. Aboard the Potomac, all was in readiness. Exactly 6 minutes after the presidential party stepped onto the ship, it headed down the Potomac River bound for Cherry Point, Virginia, in the Chesapeake Bay, 63 miles distant, where it anchored for the night. A little after 9 the next morning, the Potomac approached the USS Iowa, anchored out in the bay in deeper water. It drew up alongside, and in the very light, cool morning air, Roosevelt was placed in a sort of bosun's chair rigged from the rear sun deck of the Potomac and swung aboard the Iowa's main deck, just abreast of No. 3 turret. When the transfer of the rest of the party was completed, the Potomac vanished into the distance, ordered to cruise out of sight and away from its well-known home berth for the next week, to create the impression, in case any journalist noticed the president's absence, that he was off on another private pleasure cruise aboard what some called the floating White House because of the large amount of time he spent on it. Roosevelt had always loved the sea. As a young boy at Campobello Island in Canada, where he summered, He had learned to sail his father's sailboat, the Half Moon, a 46-foot cutter, taking it out every chance he got and handling it with ease. After he contracted polio at 39 and lost the use of his legs, he'd invested in a houseboat that he kept in Florida waters and lived on for months at a time. Now he was looking forward to the voyage of the Iowa, the Navy's newest, largest, fastest battleship. It had been specially fitted out for him, an elevator installed, ramps built over the combings and deck obstructions to accommodate his wheelchair. As in all places where FDR lived, in the bathroom there was a tub with metal railings that FDR could grasp to raise himself up, a toilet bowl exactly the height of his wheelchair, and a mirror low enough so he could shave sitting down. His favorite leather-upholstered reclining chair was also in his quarters. Half an hour after he was swung aboard, the big ship was underway. Waiting to greet FDR were all the top brass of the U.S. Armed Forces. General George C. Marshall, Chief of Staff of the U.S. Army, H.H. Hap Arnold, Commanding General of the U.S. Army Air Forces, General Brayon B. Somerville, Chief of Army Service Forces, Admiral Ernest J. King, Commander-in-Chief of the U.S. Fleet, and Admiral William Leahy, the President's Chief of Staff, plus four other generals, three more admirals, and about 50 staff officers of subordinate rank. At Roosevelt's request, no honors were rendered as he came aboard, and because of wartime restrictions, his flag was not flown. Also aboard were the eight Secret Service men who always guarded the president. So began Roosevelt's trip to meet Joseph Stalin, a meeting he had been trying to arrange for 2 years and had gone to extraordinary lengths to bring about. He and Churchill had chosen Casablanca as a meeting place the previous January because they thought there was a good chance Stalin would agree to meet them there. "We are trying to get Stalin to come," Roosevelt had confided to Mike Riley, supervising Secret Service agent at the White House, as he briefed him on the trip, firmly adding, "I won't go any further than Casablanca to meet him." But in the face of Stalin's objections to every location he suggested, the president's resolve had crumbled. Now he was going thousands of miles farther. The Tehran meeting had been planned to promote Roosevelt's dearest objective, the establishment of an international organization, a more effective version of the League of Nations, of which every nation would be a member. Such an organization, he believed, was the best, indeed the only way, to maintain a peaceful world. It would supply a forum where any member nation could state its grievance and where all nations could converse. In certain situations, it would also have the authority to act. Roosevelt planned that there would be four superpowers: the United States, the Soviet Union, Great Britain, and China, that would act as the world's four policemen. These four, with greater powers than other nations, would enforce order after the war was won. Stalin was critical to the president's plan. The war had changed nations in unforeseen ways. Post-war, only two superpowers would remain, America and Russia. Without the membership and support of the Soviet Union, Roosevelt realized, there would be no international organization. With it, the United Nations, as Roosevelt had named the proposed organization, would start out as the first true government of the world. Roosevelt expected to be challenged at his first meeting with the Soviet ruler, and he fully intended to be equal to the task. He planned to impress Stalin with his intelligence, his steadiness of character, and above all, his power. In that way, he would make the world's most paranoid ruler feel secure. He had to make Stalin comfortable with his ideas of how the world should be run when the war was over. Russia had to take part. FDR read everything he could about Stalin, who was a Georgian, a bit more than 2 years older than he, born on the southern rim of Russia to an impoverished alcoholic father and a mother who, recognizing his intelligence, had persuaded the clergy to educate him in church schools. Stalin had become a rebel, changing his name from Djugashvili to Stalin, Steel, and caught the eye of Lenin, whose successor he became. He was, like FDR, physically disabled. Two toes on his left foot were fused, giving him a slight rolling gait, and he held and used his left arm awkwardly, the result of being knocked down by a horse and carriage when he was a child. FDR received conflicting descriptions. He queried the few people he knew who had met him. One, Anna Louise Strong, a founder of the Moscow News, a weekly newspaper for Americans, remembered that FDR was particularly, almost obsessively interested in Stalin's personality. Contrary to many people's experience, she had found Stalin the easiest person to talk to I ever met. FDR knew of his violent background, that he was ruthless, that he imprisoned or killed anyone who stood in his way. In 1930, he had compared Stalin to Mussolini. In 1940, speaking to a group of students gathered at the White House, he had famously said that Stalin's dictatorship was as absolute as any other dictatorship in the world, that he was guilty of the indiscriminate killings of thousands of innocent victims. He was under no illusion as to the nature of the Soviet ruler, nor had he any thought of meddling in the Soviet Union's internal affairs. He needed Stalin, and, FDR expected, Stalin needed him as much or even more. As Roosevelt said to his personal physician, Vice Admiral Ross McIntyre, aboard the Iowa, "I bank on his realism. He must be tired of sitting on bayonets." He had arranged an Egyptian prelude, a four-day round of conferences in Cairo with Winston Churchill and Chiang Kai-shek, and he hoped Vyacheslav Molotov, the Soviet Commissar of Foreign Affairs, the second most powerful man in the Soviet Union, together with their respective military staffs. After that, he, Churchill, and Molotov would make the short hop by plane to Iran to meet with Stalin. The Cairo conference was to be the place where the four countries in concert would begin to formulate strategic plans, begin their work as Roosevelt presented it to Stalin. The meeting would underline Roosevelt's insistence that China be accepted as the fourth great power in the world, even though its power was latent and the country was both in the midst of a civil war and fighting a Japanese invasion. However, when Stalin found out the Chinese leader would be in Cairo, he canceled Molotov's trip, as well as that of the Russian military representative, because he was afraid that if Japan learned that Molotov had met with Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek, the Japanese might close the port of Vladivostok, so crucial to the Soviet war effort, or worse, unleash the Kwantung army on the Manchurian border. By the time Roosevelt learned of the cancellation, he was already on the high seas. It was a setback for Roosevelt, but not crucial, because Cairo was important mainly from a public relations standpoint. Roosevelt was the most publicity-conscious of presidents. The Russian absence would not take away from the positive publicity that would ensue from Roosevelt's public embrace of Chiang Kai-shek in such an exotic place. He was haunted by memories of the League of Nations that had failed so miserably. President Wilson had had the dream and the will, but neither the public relations skills nor the political savvy needed to make it happen. As Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Roosevelt had been in Paris winding down the U.S. naval presence in France while the Versailles Conference was taking place. He watched as Wilson was forced to agree to the vengeful clauses insisted on by his allies, their price to join the League of Nations. He had sailed for the United States on the George Washington with Wilson. At lunch in Wilson's cabin, he listened as the president loftily said, "The United States must go in or it would break the heart of the world." Roosevelt was personally persuaded of the crucial importance of the League, but he knew that Wilson was going home to inform the U.S. Senate of what membership in the League entailed, and that key Republican senators, excluded from the peace process by Wilson, indeed entirely ignored, were lying in wait for him. Wilson was attacked in the Senate and took his battle to the country. As Wilson futilely battled on, Roosevelt watched his health break down. The dream of a world government stayed with Roosevelt. He and the State Department started roughing out the plans for a world organization in 1939 as Hitler began his assault on Europe. FDR would leave no stone unturned in his quest to succeed. What he took away, what he had learned firsthand from Wilson's failure, was that it wasn't enough to have laudable goals, nor sufficient for a president to proclaim them to an enthusiastic, listening planet. After all, Wilson's 14 points had electrified the world. It was necessary to win the backing of his allies and of the U.S. Senate, and it had to be done before the war was over. FDR kept a portrait of Wilson over the mantelpiece in the cabinet room, which he used as a venue to work over speeches with his speechwriters. He would look up at it as he sat working on a speech, remembered the speechwriter, FDR biographer, and friend Robert E. Sherwood. The tragedy of Wilson was always somewhere within the rim of his consciousness. Roosevelt could never forget Wilson's mistakes. Roosevelt identified in advance the key groups he had to win over, then built consensus within each group by pointing out the practical advantages that would accrue by following his lead. Before any group was ready to make policy, Roosevelt was there, leading the way. He had taken to heart the advice given him by A. Lawrence Lowell, president of Harvard, from whom he had taken Government I his freshman year at college. The occasion was the Harvard Club annual dinner in New York in January 1933, honoring Roosevelt, when Roosevelt, as president-elect, was putting together his cabinet and top staff. Lowell, the keynote speaker, turning to face Roosevelt directly, had said that the most important principle for the chief executive was that he must always take and hold the initiative in his dealings with Congress, with his cabinet, and generally with the public. Lowell affirmed that if Roosevelt always applied this principle, he would succeed. Roosevelt, according to his Harvard classmate, Lewis Wheely, who had worked with him on the Crimson, was following Lowell's remarks with absorbed attention, and at their end he was deeply thoughtful. 2 days before he left for Tehran, Roosevelt had presided over an elaborate ceremony in the East Room of the White House, at which he and representatives of 44 countries sat around a long table and signed the agreement that set up the United Nations Relief and Rehabilitation Administration, or UNRWA. He had waited until Armistice Day, when it would get maximum exposure, to announce the establishment of this first unit of the United Nations. UNRWA, funded by the contribution of 1% of each nation's national income, would help clothe, feed, and house the people in the world's population centers that war destroyed. Its director, Herbert Lehman, the governor of New York State, according to a New York Times article that day, had just been chosen by 4 countries, the United States, Great Britain, the Soviet Union, and China. The Russians were behind the founding of UNRWA, an internationally controlled, staffed, and operated relief organization. It had been their idea, a way to put war-torn countries back on their feet. After Stalin learned that Roosevelt expected these 4 countries to run the post-war world, he had backed the idea that they would form the Executive Committee of UNRWA. The mention of the 4 countries was of the utmost importance to Roosevelt. He wanted to familiarize the world with the concept, for he was planning that the 4 policemen were going to be the core countries of the United Nations, the Organization of Nations he had brought into existence on January 1, 1942. On that first day of the new year, only 3 weeks after Pearl Harbor, Roosevelt had gathered in his White House study Winston Churchill, who was staying at the White House and represented Great Britain, Ambassador Maxim Litvinov for the Soviet Union, and Foreign Minister T.V. Sung for China to sign the UN Declaration. He signed the document himself for the United States. The first United Nations document was the initial step in Roosevelt's grand design. It bound each country to defend life, liberty, independence, and religious freedom, declared that they are now engaged in a common struggle against savage and brutal forces seeking to subjugate the world, and agreed that each government pledges itself not to make a separate armistice or peace with the enemies. The remaining 22 signatories signed the next day in alphabetical order. The name of the organization had come to Roosevelt one night when Churchill was staying at the White House. He and Churchill had been considering and discarding various titles. They had worked over the thing until late one evening, finally quitting on a phrase about countries united in fighting aggression. Then Roosevelt had gone to bed with the word united in his mind as he fell asleep. Early the next morning, he woke up with a solution, the United Nations. So impatient had he been to test the name on his house guest that, not waiting for breakfast, Roosevelt called for his man to wheel him to Churchill's door. The Prime Minister was on the same floor, down the hall, in the Rose Suite. FDR knocked. Churchill called out to him to come in, but said that he was taking a bath. A few moments later, the Prime Minister suddenly stepped out of the bathroom into the sitting room, the walls of which were decorated with scenes from Victorian England, with not a stripe on him. He looked, according to Roosevelt, like a pink cherub. Roosevelt recounted that he said, "Winston, I have it. The United Nations." "Good," said Churchill. At Cairo, Roosevelt planned to meet with Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek, head of the Chinese nationalist government, to discuss China's participation in the war against Japan. Things were going so badly in China that FDR was afraid the Chinese would fall out of the war. "Chiang's troops aren't fighting at all, despite the reports that get printed in the papers," he confided to his son, Elliot. He wanted to reinvigorate the Generalissimo and stiffen his backbone. But equally important was the publicity their meeting would generate, showcasing China as the fourth great nation in the United Nations, the fourth policeman. Roosevelt's instincts and sense of the future called for a co-equal Asian presence in the United Nations in order for it to fully represent the world. He knew that neither Churchill nor Stalin felt as he did. Their acceptance of China came only at his insistence. Nevertheless, the president would probably not have gone to Cairo except for the prospect of a Tehran meeting with Stalin. Chiang Kai-shek could have been summoned to Washington. Madame Chiang had been a White House guest the previous spring. Churchill had visited him many times in the United States. Roosevelt had arranged to meet with Churchill and Chiang Kai-shek in Cairo only after Secretary of State Cordell Hull had wired him a few weeks earlier from Moscow after meeting Stalin and informed him that the marshal was being accommodating, that a meeting with him in the Near East would probably take place, and, most important, that Stalin had told him to tell Roosevelt that immediately after the end of the war in Europe, it, the Soviet Union, will come out against Japan. Cairo was a good place to break up the trip to Tehran. All high-level meetings during the war were given code names. The code name for Tehran was Eureka, especially apt from Roosevelt's point of view, because Archimedes was supposed to have triumphantly exclaimed Eureka as he exited his bathtub, having just discovered the basic law of nature regarding volume. And this meeting was a triumph for Roosevelt. He'd been trying to set it up for more than a year. He'd been carrying on a correspondence with Stalin and lacing his messages. They had exchanged well over 100 so far, mostly concerned with U.S. and British war plans, the progress of the shipment of guns, food, planes, tanks, gasoline, plus raw materiel for Soviet factories, and lately the surrender terms for Italy, with suggestions as to where and when they could rendezvous. Stalin had continually put him off, always on the basis that, as the Supreme Commander of Soviet forces and head of the State Defense Committee, as well as head of the Supreme General Staff, he had to be in constant touch with his general staff, available to work with them to make decisions on a minute-to-minute, day-to-day basis. Therefore, he couldn't leave the country. That was perfectly true, particularly in the beginning of the war when Russia was in mortal peril. Stalin conferred daily with Marshal Alexander Vasilyevsky, chief of the Soviet general staff, and with General Georgi Zhukov, deputy supreme commander, the brave, gifted leader who had defended Moscow and Leningrad. Stalin hadn't started out with great military skills, but he had learned to listen to his generals and absorb a great deal of information, to pore over battle plans. An outstanding organizer, he displayed his ability as supremo starting with Stalingrad, mastered the technique of organizing front operations, and guided them with skill thoroughly understanding complicated strategic questions, Zhukov would write of Stalin. Now, though, as 1943 drew to a close, there was less of a sense of urgency in the Soviet Union. Leningrad was still under siege, but the Red Army had regained two-thirds of the territory seized by the Germans, had triumphed at Stalingrad in February, vanquishing and trapping 92,000 ill-clad, underfed German soldiers, the last remnants of the attacking army, and in July had won back Kursk, southwest of Moscow, in an epic battle fought by 2 million men, 6,000 tanks, and 4,000 planes. After Kursk, the German army was no longer on the offensive. By the fall of 1943, the Russians spoke of the year about to end as Prelom, the turning point. The most tangible sign of this change was that finally, in September, Stalin decided that the time had come when he could travel, leaving his generals in charge, and could meet Roosevelt face to face. Even so, he accepted Roosevelt's plan for the meeting only the day before FDR left Washington. Over the year, the two leaders had discussed various possible meeting places. Roosevelt had thrown out a number of dates and locations where they might conceivably get together. Among his suggestions had been Iceland, southern Algeria, Khartoum, the Bering Strait, Fairbanks, Cairo, and Basra. In proposing the Bering Strait, the president exhibited an imperial streak, writing, "I suggest that we could meet either on your side or my side of Bering Straits." Stalin had rejected them all. In one of the rare drafts written in his own hand, received by FDR on August 8, he first unhelpfully suggested Archangel in the far north of Russia on the White Sea, or Astrakhan in southern Russia, then wrote, "Should this proposal be inconvenient for you personally, in that case you may send to one of the above-mentioned points your responsible and fully trusted person. As I have already told Mr. Davies, I do not have any objections to the presence of Mr. Churchill at this meeting." Finally, in September, Stalin wrote that he could leave for a meeting, but the exact date of the meeting has to be defined later, taking into consideration the situation on the Soviet-German front, and suggested Tehran. Roosevelt had responded that Tehran was very difficult for him, citing constitutional obligations. "I cannot assume the delays attending flights in both directions into the saucer over the mountains in which Tehran lies. Therefore, with much regret, I must tell you that I cannot go to Tehran, and in this my cabinet members and the legislative leaders are in complete agreement." It was then that Roosevelt suggested Basra and Baghdad in Iraq, or Ankara, Turkey, closing, "Do not fail me in this crisis." Stalin had taken 2 weeks to reply, at which time he informed Roosevelt that Tehran was the only option. "For myself as Supreme Commander, the possibility of traveling farther than Tehran is excluded." Reluctantly, Roosevelt decided he had to fly over the mountains to Tehran. 3 days later, on November 8th, he wrote Stalin that he would meet him there. Roosevelt, so media-sensitive, so aware how important this meeting was in terms of public opinion, used its role as a talking point, appealing to Stalin's ego. "The whole world is watching for this meeting of the three of us." With his usual ebullient optimism, FDR went full steam ahead with his travel plans. If he had any doubts that Stalin would actually appear, he kept them to himself. Stalin had chosen a country far from American shores, but it was a country run by Americans and was not as arbitrary a choice as it first appeared. So huge was the passage of Lend-Lease shipments through Iran that an American general had been made chief of staff of the Iranian army. A top U.S. policeman was advisor to the Iranian gendarmerie, and another American was the Iranian government's chief financial advisor. In addition, the Persian Gulf Service Command, consisting of some 30,000 American soldiers, was bivouacked in two camps on the outskirts of Tehran. FDR loved to travel, by car, by train, but most especially by ship. So, worries aside, any ocean voyage on a state-of-the-art warship would have buoyed his spirits. Harry Hopkins was the only non-military advisor aboard. FDR was wary of State Department's career diplomats, many of whom were conservative Republicans. The strongly anti-Soviet Eastern European Division had been dismantled, but the vast majority of State Department career officers had been against his recognition of the Soviet Union in 1933, and although major changes had been made in the department, the ingrained antagonism to him and his policies ran deep. It hadn't helped that when he had sent Hopkins to Europe expressly to check on the Foreign Service, Hopkins found many U.S. embassies and legations still displaying photographs of Hoover on their walls instead of FDR. George Kennan, then a young Foreign Service officer, later to become famous as the author of the policy of containment, was fairly typical in his comment against Roosevelt's recognition of the Soviet Union in 1933.
We should have no relationship at all with them, never.
Neither then nor at any later date did I consider the Soviet Union a fit ally or associate, actual or potential, for this country. You should go through the experience of trying to get any changes in the thinking, policy, and action of the career diplomats, and then you'd know what a real problem it was, FDR said to the Federal Reserve Board chair, Mariner Eccles. Other quick minds also thought Foreign Service officers were stuffy beyond measure.
Communicating through the State Department is like making love through a blanket, quipped the British economist John Maynard Keynes. Nor did it help that Secretary of the Treasury Henry Morgenthau accused State Department officials of deliberately using gross procrastination as a means of condoning Hitler's extermination of the Jews.
On top of all that was FDR's belief in personal diplomacy and his confidence in his own powers of persuasion. He thought he was America's best diplomat. He knew the outcome he was seeking. He wanted to form strong ties with Russia. He looked forward to initiating exploratory conversations with Stalin on the feasibility of a world government and, while they were still allies in arms, to hammering out a consensus.
Reach a large measure of general agreement on objectives.
He was convinced that this was the necessary first step in the creation of a world government, that such a government would ensure the end of world wars, and that only a world leader himself could handle the negotiations. The absence aboard of State Department personnel served to point up how unique Hopkins was in the president's inner circle. Hopkins, 53, had many desirable qualities. He was charming, intelligent, intuitive, capable, and a bottomless well of news and gossip. Some people called him the assistant president. His ascent was based as much on his ability to judge Roosevelt's moods and needs as on his unquestioned competence. If the president was feeling low, Hopkins gathered people around. If the president needed diversion, he could sense it. If the president wanted companionship, and he often did, for he hated to be alone, Hopkins was there. If there was an important problem that needed dealing with, Roosevelt put Hopkins in charge of finding a solution. Born in Iowa, a graduate of Grinnell College, Hopkins had become a social worker. He was a superb administrator. Roosevelt, as governor of New York in 1929, had created the first statewide work relief program to deal with the millions out of work in the Depression. Hopkins ran the program so efficiently that Roosevelt brought him to Washington to help shape and run the New Deal work relief programs. With the advent of war, FDR made him head of the Munitions Assignment Board, which allocated all munitions to the Allies and to the U.S. Armed Forces. He was also in charge of directing the massive aid America was sending to the Soviet Union. He dressed atrociously. Deplorably untidy, his clothes looked as though he was in the habit of sleeping in them, and his hat as though he made a point of sitting on it, observed Winston Churchill's chief of staff, General Sir Hastings Ismay. A New Yorker profile likened his appearance to an animated piece of shredded wheat. He was bedeviled by serious digestive problems that kept him very thin. His health was not good. Surgery was done in 1937, and although the operation helped, he remained prone to severe stomach problems, for which he was periodically hospitalized. On May 10, 1940, the day the German army invaded Holland and Belgium, and Churchill became prime minister, Roosevelt invited Hopkins to dine at the White House. Hopkins had been so helpful assessing the situation and working out actions to take that as the hour grew late, FDR asked him to spend the night. Hopkins borrowed a pair of pajamas, went to sleep in one of the many bedrooms, and never returned to his home. He was given the Lincoln suite, where Abraham Lincoln had signed the Emancipation Proclamation. The suite on the second floor, the family floor, two doors away from the president's rooms, consisted of a large, high-ceilinged bedroom with a fireplace facing the South Lawn and the Washington Monument, a smaller sitting room, and a large bathroom. His desk was a card table. In July 1942, when Hopkins married Louise Macy, the former Paris editor of Harper's Bazaar, the ceremony took place in Roosevelt's study, in front of the fireplace specially banked with greens for the occasion. Louise Hopkins now moved into the Lincoln suite. Eleanor Roosevelt had initially been dubious about the addition of Louise, but Roosevelt had been firm, telling her it was absolutely necessary for Harry to be in the house. Nobody was ever as close to Roosevelt as was Hopkins. Still, Roosevelt kept him at a slight distance. Hopkins called him Mr. President, not Franklin, as Eleanor and Prime Minister Churchill did, or Frank, as did the Supreme Court Justice Felix Frankfurter. Andrei Gromyko, Soviet ambassador to the United States during the war years, remembered that Roosevelt would advise me to see Harry Hopkins about this tricky question. He may not have the answer to every question, but he'll do his best, and he'll give me an accurate account afterwards. Many people called Hopkins Roosevelt's eyes and ears. Gromyko observed that he was Roosevelt's feet as well. Hopkins was there in place of Cordell Hull. A Tennessean, a much revered figure, tall, white-haired, dignified, and imposing, Hull was the all-important bridge that linked conservative Southern Democratic senators, whose votes were needed to pass New Deal legislation, to Roosevelt. Hull was unique in the cabinet because of his power in Congress, which, observed the president, made him the only member who brings me any political strength I don't have in my own right. "Remember how Wilson lost the League of Nations," he once said to his Secretary of Labor, Frances Perkins, the first female member of a president's cabinet, "lost the opportunity for the United States to take part in the most important international undertaking ever conceived. He lost it by not getting Congress to participate." After a long career in the House, Hull had been elected to the Senate in 1930, resigning his Senate seat when Roosevelt asked him to be Secretary of State. The president relied on Hull to keep his Southern Senate colleagues in line. Roosevelt was ever mindful that the Senate had voted down membership in the League of Nations. Hull would see to it that the Senate did not vote down the United Nations. Roosevelt massaged him in public and ignored him in private, annoying Hull beyond measure. But he remained loyal. FDR not only made his own foreign policy decisions, sometimes Hull didn't even know what FDR's next move would be. The respected senior Foreign Service officer, Loy Henderson, said FDR made up the rules as he played. It was impossible, therefore, for Mr. Hull to make decisions on many occasions. Some thought personal bias caused Roosevelt to treat Hull as he did, for Hull was a bit ponderous, and he did have a bit of a judge's manner. His wife always addressed him as judge. It was hypothesized that Roosevelt, quick and intuitive, easily bored, sidelined him because of his slow, deliberate manner. And that was certainly a contributing factor. Hull also had a slight lisp, which people knew grated on FDR's ear. After the United States entered the war, Roosevelt erected a Chinese wall between foreign and military policy and excluded Hull from all conversations touching upon military affairs. As wounding as his exclusion was, Hull lived with it, and much more. "I learned from other sources than the president what had occurred at the Casablanca, Cairo, and Tehran conferences," he would admit. The war broadened Roosevelt's role. After Pearl Harbor, he placed himself at the apex of military as well as civilian planning, quickly settling into his new role and title, Commander-in-Chief. He loved the title. He was in his element, as his old friend Lewis Wheely put it. Hull had no choice but to notice it. "Please try to address me as Commander-in-Chief, not as President," Roosevelt ordered Hull, on the verge of proposing a toast to him at a cabinet dinner a year into the war. Hull did attend the Moscow Conference of Foreign Ministers in October 1943. It was the high point of his career. During the conference, he laid the groundwork for the Tehran conference that Roosevelt was on his way to now. In Moscow, the foreign ministers had agreed on the necessity of establishing a universal organization for the support of international peace and security. At the Moscow conference, in his only meeting with Stalin, Hull and his delegation had done brilliantly. In what could only be viewed as a most promising development, Hull had prevailed on the Soviet delegation to agree to something Stalin had told Roosevelt he wouldn't even have on the agenda: the participation of China. A few weeks before the conference, Stalin had written to Roosevelt, "If I understood you correctly, at the Moscow conference will be discussed questions concerning only our three countries, and thus it can be considered as agreed upon that the question of the declaration of the four nations is not included in the agenda of the conference."
Roosevelt simply ignored this statement. Instead, he wrote to Stalin about Italian issues, problems with the French, and the series of places where their meeting might take place. Hull fought hard for Roosevelt. He succeeded not only in bringing the issue of China up for discussion at the conference, but in having the Chinese ambassador in Moscow, Fu Pingxiong, sign the joint four-nation declaration, along with Molotov, Anthony Eden, the Foreign Secretary of Great Britain, and himself. Molotov, presumably following the orders he had been given by Stalin, had attempted to derail this turn of events. He grudgingly agreed that he would have no objection if the Chinese signed later, but he continued to insist on the idea of a three-power declaration. Hull suddenly dug in his heels and told Molotov that if the Soviets did not agree to the inclusion of China in the original document, he, the secretary, would pack his bags and return to Washington. Molotov, thereupon, had scratched off a message to Stalin, and the meeting was resumed. In order to hold the point in discussion without a vote, the secretary took the floor and, in a sense, filibustered the meeting until the reply from Stalin was received. Molotov opened the note, smiled broadly, and said, "The Soviet government welcomes the inclusion of China in the four-power declaration." The British interpreter, A.H. Bierce, watching, observed that as the conference progressed, Stalin seemed to be hovering behind the scenes all the time. The declaration provided for united action against the enemy, unanimity on terms of surrender, and the creation of an international peacekeeping organization based on the principle of the sovereign equality of all peace-loving states. This was the first instance of Stalin's bending to Roosevelt's wishes. It was closely followed by another victory. The Senate passed the Connolly Resolution that provided for post-war international collaboration and the establishment of a general international organization. This bill, a senatorial green light for the United Nations, immeasurably added to FDR's peace of mind. The president had been so pleased with the passage of the resolution, as well as the outcome of the Moscow conference, that he was at Washington's National Airport to greet Hull as he stepped off the big army cargo plane that brought him home. It was a huge and unexpected honor. "We'll give you the keys to the city," the New York Times reporter covering the scene quoted the president as saying to Hull. Harry Hopkins took Cordell Hull's place on the trip to Tehran. Roosevelt knew that he could count on Hull's loyalty and that Hull was not physically up to another long trip so close on the heels of the first one. Eleanor Roosevelt, inveterate traveler that she was, had wanted to go to Tehran, in fact, pleaded with the president to take her. Roosevelt refused. "Absolutely no women," he decreed. Their daughter, Anna Bettiger, who was present at the conversation, reported to her husband, John, "The O.M., old man, sat all over her and hurt her feelings." Anna, too, asked to go. For Anna, he had a ready answer. No women were allowed on shipboard. Anna was furious, particularly because two of her brothers, Elliot, a colonel in the army, and Franklin, a lieutenant in the navy, were invited. "O.M. is a stinker in his treatment of the female members of his family," Anna wrote to her husband, who also would join the presidential party in Cairo. So, journeying to meet Joseph Stalin, to coordinate the war strategy of the three nations, and to plan for the post-war world, Roosevelt brought along his generals, admirals, personal staff of cooks, stewards and valets, and his capable friend, Harry. There was one other non-military foreign policy advisor in addition to Hopkins, Averill Harriman, with whom Roosevelt was close, who would be at Tehran. Roosevelt had sent Harriman to London to set up the initial Lend-Lease program with Churchill, and then to Moscow in October 1941 to work out Soviet needs with Stalin and Molotov. Harriman, who had become ambassador to Russia the month before, in time to take part in the Moscow conference, was waiting in Cairo. Energetic, peripatetic, aristocratic, handsome even among diplomats. As the New Yorker described him, Harriman was slim, 6 feet 1 inch tall, with dark hair, deep-set brown eyes, and clean-cut features. He spoke no foreign languages. "My French is excellent," Harriman once said, "except for the verbs," which was the closest anyone ever heard him come to making a joke. He was enormously wealthy, a partner of Brown Brothers Harriman and chairman of the board of the Union Pacific Railroad. He was as well a star athlete who had been an 18-goal polo player in his younger days, ranked fourth in the nation. Like the president, he had gone to Groton, but he then chose Yale, where he had become a member of the legendary secret society Skull and Bones. His family also had a Hudson River estate, Arden House, on the west side of the Hudson, upriver from Roosevelt's Springwood. Unusually for his class and business career, he was a Democrat. Because Roosevelt had raised taxes, established Social Security, and put into place a minimum wage, all of which addressed the needs of the working class, and had then created the Securities and Exchange Commission to regulate the stock market, the vast majority of wealthy, conservative Americans despised him, calling him a traitor to his class. When the news filtered out to his Wall Street friends that Harriman had gone to work for Roosevelt, they were horrified. The hate Roosevelt sentiment ran strong. When I walked down Wall Street, men I had known all my life crossed to the other side so they would not have to shake my hand, Harriman recalled. Harriman, who in common with Roosevelt had an impatience with details and a dislike of going through channels, was perfectly comfortable circumventing the State Department bureaucracy and his nominal boss, Hull, taking it as normal that on the president's orders he reported directly to him. He was a year younger than Hopkins, and they were great friends. Hopkins had proposed to his wife in Harriman's suite at the Mayflower Hotel in Washington, as he and Louise were about to go out for dinner with Harriman and his wife, Marie. On weekends at Harriman's house in Sands Point, Long Island, whenever they could, the two men locked horns over croquet, at which Harriman was superb. Safety precautions on the president's voyage were extreme. 9 destroyers and 1 aircraft carrier took turns guarding the Iowa, which itself had 157 guns, 2 catapults, and 3 observation scout planes. At all times, 6 destroyers operated as anti-submarine screens. Other ships, including the aircraft carrier Santee, were part of a task force that stood 25 miles to the north. Fighter planes kept watch, flying sorties over the ship. The Iowa steamed at an average of 23 knots at readiness 3, which meant that 1/3 of its crew was on watch at battle stations at all times. Once at sea, the Iowa could receive messages but not send. Dispatches to Washington were relayed from the Iowa by the destroyers, which would drop away before they made radio contact with the outside world. Messages were kept to an absolute minimum because Roosevelt's safety depended on keeping his whereabouts unknown. One message the Iowa did receive had to do with Churchill's wish to change the scene of the conference from Cairo to Malta. Because there seemed to be no reason for the change, the security staff viewed it as one of the Prime Minister's fits of whimsy. So did Roosevelt. When apprised of the message, he immediately replied, "No change in my plans as to Cairo. Repeat, no change in my plans as to Cairo." The only serious incident, and one that came uncomfortably close to killing the president, happened on the second day out when the William D. Porter, the anti-submarine destroyer stationed to starboard, laying on a special exhibition of gunnery for the commander-in-chief, inexplicably and incredibly launched a torpedo straight at the Iowa. According to Roosevelt's notes on the incident, the destroyer in the escort was holding torpedo drill, using the Iowa as the spotting target. The firing charge was left in the torpedo tube, contrary to regulations. The torpedo was fired, and the aim was luckily bad. Admiral King was, of course, much upset, and will, I fear, take rather drastic disciplinary action. We fired the secondary battery to try to divert the torpedo. Finally, we saw it explode a mile or two astern. An observant young assistant navigator, John Driscoll, recorded the incident. On what he called an amethystin sea, in balmy weather, while the president was sitting on the promenade deck, portside, wearing a maroon polo shirt, gray flannel pants, white fisherman's hat and sunglasses, and Admiral King, Marshall, Leahy et al. Were on the bridge walkways watching an exhibition of balloon shooting, the William D. Porter signaled emergency. I could hear the captain roaring, "Right full rudder," into the conning tower, and we began to turn and vibrate mightily. Coming at us, at not more than 5 knots, was a broaching fish. I glanced down at the port promenade deck below me where the president was sitting. As the ship kept swinging to starboard, the torpedo seemed to veer aft as though it would strike us in our port quarter. My eyes came back to the president, Hopkins, and Prettyman, Arthur Prettyman, the president's valet. Hopkins was leaning far out over the lifeline, following the course of the torpedo aft. Prettyman had whirled the president's armless wheelchair aft. "Take me to the starboard rail," FDR had called out. And he, too, was facing the rear of the ship, his right hand flung out, grasped a lifeline at his side, his head was held high, intent, curious, and fearless. It was an awe-inspiring picture, the spell broken in me only when I heard a detonation and felt a jar that seemed to come from our port quarter. Then general quarters was sounded, and I hurried to my battle station in the chart house, wondering if we'd been hit. Word came to the bridge that the ship had not been hit in the port quarter, but the torpedo had exploded in the great wake churned up by our turning track, probably detonated by the port quarter batteries, which were firing at last.
Navy records showed the torpedo was traveling at 46 knots. The Iowa's maximum speed was 33.5 knots. According to sailors on the ship, the commanding officer, Captain John L. McCrae, practically turned the Iowa on her ear to avoid the torpedo. Countermanding Admiral King, Roosevelt ordered that no punishment be meted out to the sailors at fault. He was merely being practical. The enormity of the gaff was such that he was afraid that had the skipper of the destroyer become aware that Admiral King, General Marshall, all the top brass of the U.S. military establishment, plus the president were on board, he might have plunged himself to the bottom of the sea rather than face the awful consequences. Most days the sea was smooth, the temperature usually 70 degrees, allowing the president to be on deck and take the air, which he loved to do. All goes well in a very comfortable trip so far. Weather good and warm enough to sit with only a sweater over an old pair of trousers and a fishing shirt, he wrote to Eleanor. In the evenings after dinner, there were usually movies in the president's quarters. This will be another odyssey, much further afield and afloat than the hardy Trojan whose name I used to take at Groton when I was competing for school prizes, wrote Roosevelt in a diary he began while on the trip. During the days, the Joint Chiefs of Staff held strategy conferences among themselves, as well as meetings with the president. At the meeting on November 19th in the president's cabin, when General Marshall asked about post-war Germany, Roosevelt replied, "There would definitely be a race for Berlin. The United States should have Berlin." Roosevelt sketched on a National Geographic map the American zone he wanted, the northwestern part of Germany, which would meet the Russian zone to the east in Berlin. The Joint Chiefs of Staff anticipated trouble with Churchill. They wanted to make sure Roosevelt didn't accept Churchill's arguments to delay Overlord, the codename for the cross-channel attack, particularly now when he was on his way to meet Stalin, to whom he had been promising a second front, as the Russians referred to it, for well over a year. Roosevelt had caved in to Churchill's delaying tactics on the invasion before, and now all concerned, from Hopkins to Marshall to Leahy, were worried it might happen again. Secretary of War Henry L. Stimson, 15 years older than FDR, and highly respected by him as an open-minded, patriotic Republican, had had Hopkins to lunch in his office at the Pentagon the day before he left for Tehran, expressly to explore how they could stiffen the president's resolve. "We took up first the question of Overlord, which we both agreed was the most important problem now before the world, and about which we are both anxious, owing to the very doubtful attitude of the British Prime Minister. My object was to cheer up Harry and give him my ideas as to how he was to hold the president in line if he could. I have no doubt of the British people doing it. It's merely that their Prime Minister is balking," Stimson wrote in his diary. Churchill's delaying tactics took the form of pressing for a continued push to divert troops to capture the Dodecanese Islands in the Mediterranean, and mount diversionary battles in Italy. Realizing that the conflict with their British counterparts would be over the question of unified command over all European operations, Leahy, Marshall, and King decided that their strategy would be to insist on the immediate naming of one overall commander, an American, who could veto an operation before it reached the planning stage. Their shipboard meeting resulted in unanimity that this command should be vested in a single commander, and he should exercise command over the Allied force commanders in the Mediterranean, in Northwest Europe, and of the strategic air forces. While the Iowa was at sea, the radio room was notified that the Germans were using their new glide torpedoes at the entrance to the Strait of Gibraltar. These torpedoes, which magnetically locked onto their targets when dropped into the water, were wreaking havoc on Allied ships in the narrow passage. The Iowa had to pass through the strait to reach its destination, Oran, Algeria, in the Mediterranean. A message went out to the Iowa to be prepared to change course for Dakar, Senegal. An hour after the message was sent, it was learned that there was a strong concentration of German submarines off Dakar, at which point it was decided to adhere to the original schedule and head for Oran. Orders went out to Admiral Kent Hewitt, commander of the U.S. Northwest Africa Naval Forces, to assemble planes, submarines, everything he could to clear the strait and keep it clear. He did. A U.S. plane saw and sank one German sub. There were no others. Blacked out, the Iowa went through the strait at night. Spanish authorities on Gibraltar contributed a final tense moment by silhouetting the Iowa in the beams of their searchlights as it passed into the Mediterranean. After the 8-day voyage, the Iowa docked at the naval anchorage near Oran on a clear, bright Saturday morning. Two of Roosevelt's sons, Elliot and Franklin, waited. They saw him being lowered into the Iowa's motorized whaleboat. Coming ashore a few moments later, Roosevelt gave his sons a big hello and a healthy sea-tanned grin. Then father and sons immediately drove, with General Eisenhower, commander of Operation Torch, the invasion of French North Africa, who was waiting with his car, to the nearby airport, where they boarded the president's plane, a 4-engine Douglas C-54. They would land first in Tunis to refuel for the long flight to Cairo, and after the meetings there, FDR would fly on to Tehran to meet the elusive Premier Stalin. Chapter 2. Traveling to Tehran. Escorted by fighters, Major Otis Bryan flew the presidential party on the 650-mile flight to Tunis, tracing the North African coastline. Hopkins's son, Sergeant Robert Hopkins, a Signal Corps photographer, was waiting to greet them at the airfield. The plan had been that Roosevelt would spend the night in General Eisenhower's guest villa, located just beyond the ruins of Carthage, on the shore of the Gulf of Tunis. Before Eisenhower, the villa had been Field Marshal Erwin Rommel's residence until he was routed by General Bernard Montgomery's 8th Army earlier in the year. In the morning, FDR was scheduled to fly to Cairo, but the flight was delayed until late the next evening. The official explanation for the change was that flying at night was safer because the Germans still held the island of Crete. But it was also true that FDR was in no hurry to get to Cairo, no hurry to see Churchill, and if he stayed in Tunis, he could use the time getting to know General Eisenhower. The president had told everyone Marshall was going to command D-Day, but he had actually not yet made up his mind. He used the day to tour battle sites with Eisenhower. Their car was driven by the general's attractive young driver, Kay Summersby, who had been an ambulance driver during the London Blitz and, as a member of the British Mechanized Transport Corps, had been assigned to Eisenhower in 1942. Breaking for a picnic lunch near a grove of trees, Roosevelt spotted, the three sat and talked. They were not exactly alone. Three trucks and 8 motorcycles, manned by military police, ringed the car at a distance, plus the usual Secret Service personnel. As the three inside relaxed and ate chicken sandwiches, FDR, remembered Summersby, told them stories and asked and answered questions. He was checking out the general. At 10:40 that night, accompanied by generals, admirals, Secret Service men, Hopkins, Leahy, McIntyre, and his valet, Arthur Prettyman, the president took off in the Douglas C-54 bound for Cairo. a flight of 1,851 miles. A rigged-up bed awaited him on the plane, a rubber mattress stretched across two seats from which the backs had been removed, closed off by a green curtain so that the president could sleep. A clear, beautiful dawn was breaking as they approached the Egyptian coastline. Roosevelt had asked Bryan to detour southward and Riley to wake him at dawn so that, as it became daylight, he could follow the course of the Nile to Cairo and see the southernmost pyramids, the monuments, and the Sphinx. Riley called him at 7 a.m. As the spectacle of the river unfolded and the monuments came into view, Major Bryan circled so that Roosevelt could get his fill of the majestic panorama. Commented Roosevelt after looking at the pyramids, "Man's desire to be remembered is colossal." It didn't seem to bother him that because of his sightseeing proclivities, the plane was more than 2 hours off schedule, and the two groups of P-39s ordered to rendezvous with and guard his plane never found it. He was not overly concerned with physical danger. It was said the only thing he was afraid of was fire. He had had plenty of exposure. As a child of three, he had been at his grandfather Delano's house, Algonac, in Newburgh, New York, down the Hudson from Hyde Park, when his mother's youngest sister, Laura, curling her hair too close to an oil lamp, flew down the steps and out onto the lawn, wrapped in a robe that was aflame. The family saw her and tried to help her, but it was too late. She couldn't be saved. At the age of 17, FDR helped the farm superintendent at Springwood tear up part of the floor in the parlor and throw water on the cellar beams, which were on fire. That same winter at Groton, he was in the bucket brigade that tried to save a stable full of horses and remembered a horrible scene, the poor horses lying under the debris with their hide entirely burned off. He was at Harvard when the top two floors of Trinity Hall burned. As editor of the Crimson, he fought for the installation of dormitory fire escapes. In 1915, when Springwood was rebuilt, he insisted that the walls be fireproof. At Shangri-La, the president's wartime retreat in Catoctin Mountain Park in Maryland, he had an escape hatch built into the outer wall of his lodge near his bedroom door. It was hinged at the bottom to open outward, forming a ramp he could either be wheeled down and out or crawl down and out. Roosevelt was typically a curious traveler, always interested in seeing the places of which he had such detailed geographic knowledge. His deep, continuing interest in stamps, which he had started collecting when he was 10 years old, both arose from and fueled his interest in geography. He now had more than 1 million stamps, collected in 150 matching volumes, which he worked on whenever he had a chance. Several volumes, always the heaviest items in his luggage, went with him wherever he went. The previous January, when flying from Bathurst, Canada, to Casablanca, he had ordered a detour so that he could look at Dakar, the seaport on the westernmost tip of Africa that jutted out into the Atlantic and dominated the North and South Atlantic shipping lanes, so crucial to the Allied cause that had caused such anguish until taken during Operation Torch. In Cairo, FDR was lodged at a villa on a canal near the base of the Great Pyramid and the Sphinx, belonging to Alexander Kirk, the American ambassador to Egypt. Churchill's villa was a half-mile distant. Because Cairo was filled with Axis spies and the city was seething with unrest, security was extreme. Riley set up barbed wire entanglements, patrolled by troops 24 hours a day around both residences, closed down the tour guides and their camels at the pyramids, and replaced the household servants at both villas with American and British mess staff. Winston Churchill, Chiang Kai-shek, this would be his first meeting with the president, and Madame Chiang were waiting impatiently for FDR in Cairo. All three were looking forward to conferring with Roosevelt as well as his principal advisors, General Marshall, Admiral King, General Arnold, Admiral Leahy, and, of course, Hopkins. But if the meetings were of first importance to them, they were of secondary importance to Roosevelt now that Molotov would not be present. The Cairo conference had been scheduled for a variety of reasons: to publicize the importance of China to the war effort, to allow Churchill and the British military to confer with Roosevelt and the American military establishment, and to give Molotov a taste of what was to come in Tehran. But another reason was the inescapable fact that it provided a cover for Tehran, a valid excuse for a long ocean voyage by the president in case Stalin did not show.
Without the Russian presence, Robert E. Sherwood would later write, aside from the declaration assuring the freedom and independence of Korea, the effect of these meetings on the progress of the war or on history was negligible. Churchill was pleased Molotov would not be present in Cairo. It was his view that the combined American and British chiefs of staff should decide on tactics and strategy before meeting the Russians. He was therefore planning on many meetings between the two staffs during the 4 days in Cairo, particularly because the combined chiefs had not met in more than 3 months. He wanted, in essence, to erect a wall with the president and himself on one side and Stalin on the other. That was exactly what Roosevelt did not want. He had warned the prime minister politely a few days prior to the meeting that he was going to limit discussions as to strategy as much as possible because it would be a terrible mistake if UJ, Roosevelt and Churchill sometimes referred to Stalin as Uncle Joe between themselves, thought we had ganged up on him on military action. Roosevelt was carefully but systematically limiting the ties, not of friendship, but of partnership with Churchill. The Prime Minister fought against it, as did the British Foreign Secretary, Anthony Eden. In Roosevelt's mind, Great Britain was on a par with his other two allies, China and Russia. He was supreme. He therefore avoided having the opening Cairo conference be a joint Anglo-American meeting by the simple expedient of inviting Chiang Kai-shek to attend. He also instructed Marshall, Leahy, and King that he wanted their meeting with Chiang to be separate from and precede any meeting with the British. Anthony Eden later painfully described the situation to the British War Cabinet. It was unfortunate from our point of view that the conference in Cairo opened with a discussion of the Japanese war on account of the presence of Chiang Kai-shek. Roosevelt conferred with Chiang at length. Britain still had extraterritorial rights to Shanghai, Canton, and Hong Kong. Chiang wanted British warships out of Chinese ports after the war. FDR promised him, "That's what will happen." Chinese matters, Churchill later complained, lengthy, complicated, and minor, occupied first instead of last place at Cairo. So devious was Roosevelt that the U.S. staff floated comments that led the British to believe, remembered Lord Ismay, Churchill's chief of staff, that the Chinese had arrived before they were meant to, which was not the case. The American chiefs of staff, so far from upset by the premature arrival of the Chinese delegation, seemed positively pleased to have a chaperone, Ismay observed. It was no secret to any member of the American military staff that Churchill did not favor Operation Overlord, the invasion of France, or that Roosevelt relied almost exclusively on Marshall's advice, and that the central tenet of Marshall's European war plan was Operation Overlord. Roosevelt had chosen Marshall in April 1939 because he was smart, like himself an independent thinker, and had a reputation dating from World War I for speaking his mind. Without consulting anyone, even his then Secretary of War, Harry Woodring, Roosevelt decided to jump Marshall over the four generals who outranked him and make him chief of staff. Roosevelt liked to meet with his Sunday and evening visitors in his oval study on the second floor of the White House. He used the room a great deal. It was convenient and easy for him because his bedroom was next door. The room was handsome and informal, with books piled high on some tables, models of famous sailboats resting on others. Besides his desk, there was a scattering of comfortable chairs and a big leather sofa where FDR sat when he had company. In front of the sofa was a tiger rug. Prints and paintings of the great sailing vessels of the 19th and early 20th centuries lined the walls, a small part of his collection of more than 1,200 naval prints and paintings. It was the room of someone who loved the sea. Behind the desk was a sheaf of roll-out maps, set so that Roosevelt could pull them out. The two women who bookended his life were also present. The portraits of his wife and his mother faced each other on opposite walls. On a Sunday in April 1939, Roosevelt summoned Marshall to the room to tell him he was making him chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Marshall, a rather stiff, formal man, said he replied that he wanted the right to say what I think, and it would often be unpleasing. Is that all right? He said yes. From Roosevelt's point of view,
Marshall was ideal for the job. He was not only independent, but indefatigable, efficient, and dedicated. His word was rarely questioned because it was conceded that he was always right. The announcement of his appointment was made on September 1, 1939, the day Germany invaded Poland. Marshall was sure that the way to beat Hitler was to build up Allied forces in England, ferry them across the Channel, invade France, and march on to Berlin. It was the shortest route and would result in the fewest casualties. Secretary of War Henry Stimson agreed. Roosevelt fully backed the plan, codenamed Overlord, which had been in the planning stages for 2 years. Stalin had been led to believe that it would take place in 1942 or 1943. Churchill, by contrast, could be said to be lukewarm at best on the cross-channel operation. He wanted to attack through the Balkans. He also, according to his doctor, who was his confidant, was haunted by memories of the Battle of the Somme in World War I, during which so many British soldiers had died. When the combined chiefs finally sat down together, without the president and the prime minister at Cairo, the subject of their talks was almost exclusively the war in Asia. General Ismay complained that there was no time left to reach agreement as to the exact line which should be taken with the Russians about a second front in Europe. That was Roosevelt's plan. Roosevelt's circle had learned this technique from their chief. The president used it when he wanted to stifle debate without seeming to, and reach consensus where there was contention. At a meeting, he would simply preempt the conversation or perhaps introduce a new subject, dawdle along, talking about various things or even tell stories, in order to compress the decision into the final moments of a meeting. Then, for lack of time, the decision he wanted, even if unpopular or unexpected, could not be challenged. Churchill attempted to hide his lack of enthusiasm for the cross-channel invasion from Hopkins, but he wasn't subtle enough. Winston said he was 100% for Overlord, but it was very important to capture Rome, and then we ought to take Rhodes, Hopkins noted mockingly 2 days before they were due to arrive in Tehran. Hopkins would probably not have been surprised to learn that the British plan, according to Major General Sir John Kennedy, Assistant Chief of the Imperial General Staff, was to continue the offensive in Italy, to increase the flow of supplies to partisans in the Balkans, to bring about an upheaval by inducing the Balkan powers to break away from Germany, to induce Turkey to enter the war, and to accept a postponement of Overlord. Kennedy would also write, "Had we had our way, I think there can be little doubt that the invasion of France would not have been done in 1944. Churchill had been arguing incessantly and obdurately against Overlord for another reason. He mistrusted Stalin. As he had explained to Averill Harriman earlier in the year, Stalin's unrelenting pressure for a second front in 1943 sprang from his designs on the Balkans. What better way to keep the Western Allies from landing in the Balkans than to tie them down in a long and costly battle for Western Europe? He had been very effective thus far in postponing Overlord. His dogged pursuit of divergent war plans was actually a tactic to engage in battles that would tie up Allied troops and the crucial landing craft basically anywhere, so they wouldn't be available for the cross-channel invasion. Roosevelt, used to arguing with Churchill, left Cairo in high good humor but on guard, as is apparent in the note he wrote to his secretary, Grace Tully, the day after Thanksgiving. "The conference goes fairly well. My role is that of peacemaker. I've seen the pyramids and made close friends with the Sphinx. Congress should know her." All of this set the stage for Tehran. The president wasn't sure where he was going to live in Tehran or how long he would stay. Both things depended on Stalin. He was going beyond caution in being so accommodating so that Stalin would have no excuse to back out. The morning he arrived in Cairo, Monday, November 22nd, Roosevelt had sent Stalin a message that he would reach Tehran on November 29th and would remain for 2 to 4 days, depending upon how long you can find it possible to be away from your compelling responsibilities. He had then asked that Stalin let him know what day you wished to set for our meeting, and commented that the Soviet legation and the British legation in Tehran were situated near each other, whereas my legation is some distance away,
which would mean driving to and fro and thus taking unnecessary risks. At the end of the message, Roosevelt had posed a seemingly casual but sharp question, fishing for an invitation to stay at the Russian embassy as Stalin's guest. "Where do you think we should live?" he asked. This was a charmingly audacious strategy, to show his confidence in Stalin by putting himself in Stalin's hands, hoping to win his trust as quickly as possible. He could, of course, have stayed at the British embassy if it was merely a matter of security considerations. Churchill had already asked him to do just that, and would have been thrilled if he had agreed. But because FDR intended to present himself to Stalin as a unique and trustworthy leader, and America as the major force in the world, he wanted to make sure that he was perceived as standing alone. He had refused. He didn't want the Prime Minister of Great Britain, the former secretary in charge of the colonies of the greatest colonial empire in the world, wound round his neck like a millstone. That was why Roosevelt had started the distancing in Cairo, serving notice on the British there that he expected to have a free hand in Tehran, behavior that was causing Churchill considerable anguish. The presidential party drove to the Cairo West Airport, waited until a light fog lifted, and took off a little after 7 a.m. Major Bryan then flew the 1,300 miles east to Tehran over the Suez Canal and circled twice at a low altitude over Jerusalem while FDR pointed out prominent landmarks. They flew over Bethlehem, Jericho, the River Jordan, the Dead Sea, flew over the desert that was Palestine, flew east, and descended again over the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. Then Bryan turned northeast, circled Baghdad, and headed for Iran. Once in Iranian airspace, they saw below them the U.S.-staffed freight trains on the Trans-Iranian Railroad carrying lend-lease supplies, as well as American and British convoys carrying more American lend-lease supplies over the Abadan-Tehran highway that ran from Basra on the Persian Gulf to Tehran. More than 100,000 tons a month were moving to Russia through Iran. Tehran, the capital of Iran, lies in the southern foothills of the Alborz Mountains, which run parallel to the Caspian Sea and rise to almost 19,000 feet. The previous January, about to fly over the Atlas Mountains on the way to the Casablanca Conference, Ross McIntyre had wanted Roosevelt, who suffered from chronic sinusitis, to put on his oxygen mask. But fearing that if he asked him to, the president would refuse, McIntyre had resorted to trickery. He enlisted the aid of Admiral McCrae, asking him to put on his face mask, after which he would put on his own, explaining, "If I suggest it to him, he probably won't do it. However, if he sees us with ours on, he'll probably follow suit." The subterfuge had worked. FDR had reached for his oxygen mask, and away we went over the mountains. Now, as they approached Tehran and saw the mountains encircling the city, McIntyre was ready to reach for an oxygen mask, but the perfect visibility enabled Bryan to stay under 6,000 feet and successfully snake his plane through the twisting mountain passes. The plane landed at the Russian army field, Gali Morgi, 5 miles south of the city, on Saturday, November 27, 1943, at 3 p.m. Exiting the plane, the presidential party saw that the field was covered with newly arrived U.S. Lend-Lease planes, each sporting a huge, shiny, red Soviet star. The airfield was ringed with Iranian soldiers, but in the interests of security, Major General D.H. Connolly, commanding general of the Persian Gulf Service Command, stood alone on the tarmac to greet the president's plane and usher him and his party into a car for the ride to the American legation. The American legation was fully prepared, expecting to house FDR and his party. The American diplomatic community, including Louis G. Dreyfus, the U.S. minister to Iran, had been kept in the dark as to the upcoming conference until the very last moment. Dreyfus had returned from a trip to find soldiers installing a new telephone system in the complex and army tents on the legation lawn. He had then been told the president was coming, that the president would stay at the legation, and that he had to move out. Roosevelt made the long, dangerous trip to Tehran to get to know Stalin, and for that plan to work, it was important to distance himself from Churchill and retain the uniquely positive impression the Russians had of him. As a New Deal president,
Roosevelt had won the approval of Pravda and of Stalin from the start of his presidency. FDR had ignored the anti-communist sentiment endemic in America and forced the recognition of the Soviet Union by the United States the year he took office. Stalin had been waiting 14 years for that to happen. Now FDR was intent on clearly and painstakingly demonstrating to Stalin that the United States was on its own path and that he was playing his own hand. For that, he knew instinctively details were important. Given the paranoid, suspicious personality he was dealing with, in retrospect it seems remarkably clever that Roosevelt went to such great lengths to start off the relationship on the right foot. Roosevelt had sent Stalin the cable asking him where he should stay, essentially fishing for an invitation, only 5 days before he was due to arrive. It had gone out from the map room in Washington at 2:55 p.m. on November 22nd. The embassy delivered the cable to the Kremlin, which dated it as received on November 24th, no hour. It was then translated and delivered to Stalin, but 2 days had passed since it was sent. By that time, Stalin was well on his way by train to Tehran, and the train was having serious communications problems. In the meantime, Andrei Vyshinsky, the first assistant commissar for foreign affairs, called on the president and, possibly after a few hints, invited him to stay at the Russian embassy in Tehran. Vyshinsky, however, a small man with bright black eyes, horn-rimmed glasses, thinning reddish hair and a mustache, had presided over the infamous Moscow show trials in 1936-38 and was notorious as cringingly sycophantic to his seniors. State Department and presidential records are silent as to their appraisal of him in Cairo, but it was obvious that the invitation did not have Stalin's approval or the stamp of an official invitation. Nevertheless, the day after that, the 24th, Riley had walked through the Russian embassy as well as the British and U.S. embassies to check security issues and suitability. The Russian and British embassies not only were in the center of Tehran, but had gardens back-to-back across the street from each other. Therefore, with a fence thrown up across the street, the two embassies could be connected. The American legation, a mile away, was pronounced adequate by Riley. He said the route to the other embassies presented no security problems, although distance would later be cited as the main reason that Roosevelt stayed in the Russian compound. The traffic in Tehran was indeed horrendous. The streets were thronged with people, cars, and horse-drawn droshkies, slowing traffic to a crawl. "We have made no commitments as to a residence for the president," Riley stated. "He can stay at the U.S., the British, or the Russian embassy if invited." The British embassy would probably have been the least comfortable of the three, judging by Lord Ismay's description of it as a ramshackle house built by the Indian Public Works Department. Major General Patrick Hurley, former Secretary of War, distinguished-looking, a smooth talker, whom Roosevelt had appointed minister to New Zealand, was in Tehran as Roosevelt's personal representative. He cabled FDR on Friday morning, November 26, to say that the Russian chargé d'affaires, Mikhail Maximov, had actually come through with a formal invitation to stay. "The Russian government cordially invites you to be its guest at its embassy while here." However, as the invitation still lacked Stalin's imprimatur, it was refused. Upon inspection, Hurley found that the conference location and Roosevelt's possible living quarters were both located in the main embassy building of the Soviet compound, which included several smaller buildings. It was a large, handsome, square building, built of light brown stone, fronted by a wide portico with white Doric columns. It stood in the center of a large park that contained a lake, fountains, flower beds, and a network of walking paths. Hurley pronounced it as ideal a place for Roosevelt to stay as could be found in Tehran. It had the additional attribute of being the only building heated by steam in the entire city. Portable oil stoves served for all other buildings. This was an important consideration because the days were mild, but the nights cold. It had a pleasant vista, with windows fronting on the cedars, willows, and ponds of the embassy gardens that surrounded it. The quarters earmarked for the president consisted of a large bedroom, a sitting room next to the conference room that would be the main venue for the meetings, a large dining room, a kitchen deemed adequate for the Filipino messboys from Shangri-La who prepared the president's meals,
plus a few smaller bedrooms. The Russians, in fact, had gone to a great deal of trouble fixing up the residence for FDR. All Soviet personnel who worked in the office buildings and lived in the apartments on the grounds had been ordered to take their belongings and move to other quarters in the city by the evening of November 17th. Worried that Roosevelt's wheelchair would not fit through ordinary doorways, they had torn out and widened all the door openings where Roosevelt might pass. The bathroom was undergoing major changes, Hurley saw. The bathtub, toilets, and sinks had been ripped out, new ones in evidence were waiting to be installed. If Roosevelt had known earlier in the month of the work that had been going on, of the meticulous preparations that had started the first of the month and gone into high gear by mid-November, he would have been less worried. Hurley reported, "From the standpoint of your convenience and comfort, from the standpoint of conference communications and security, these quarters are far more desirable than your own legation." He gave the Russians a list of the furnishings FDR would need. However, even though the Russians, as he told the president, still most cordially solicit your acceptance of their invitation, he advised the Russians that Roosevelt planned to stay in the American legation. The rooms weren't ready. There was no word from Stalin. Roosevelt and his party proceeded directly to the American legation, where Minister Dreyfus and Hurley waited. In the afternoon, Admiral Brown and Dreyfus went to the Soviet embassy, where they were met by the chargé d'affaires, Maximov, who told them that he himself had not yet heard from the marshal. With all the Russians virtually paralyzed by Stalin's lack of input, Brown and Dreyfus retreated, saying that Roosevelt would stay at his own legation. When told that Stalin had finally arrived, Roosevelt took the initiative. Seemingly confident that Stalin intended no slight in not responding to his wish to stay at the Russian embassy, he proceeded through Harriman to invite him to dinner. The marshal declined on the grounds that he had had a strenuous day and that it would be better to stay with the original plan and meet the following afternoon. Roosevelt had, to borrow a phrase from John Maynard Keynes, the gift of instinctive judgment, and he was exhibiting it now. Stalin had indeed had a difficult trip. If he had not been interested in the shape of the post-war world and Russia's place in it, which he expected to work out with Roosevelt, he would not have subjected himself to the ordeal. He hated to travel. He had journeyed to Stockholm, London, and Berlin for party congresses as a young revolutionary, but his last trip outside the Soviet Union had been in 1913, when he had joined Lenin in Vienna. He had only visited the front once, although he intimated to Roosevelt and Churchill that he went often. Stalin rarely traveled beyond his dacha at Kuntsevo, about 5.5 miles from the Kremlin, except to go to his dacha at Sochi, the showplace village perched in the foothills of the snow-peaked Caucasus Mountains on the edge of the Black Sea. Stalin had his winter vacation house there because of its famous sulfur baths. He was a hypochondriac, but he also suffered at various times from psoriasis, tonsillitis, occasionally from nephritis, pleurisy, and asthma, and from his years of exile in Siberia, rheumatism. It was to deal with all his ailments that he spent so much time at Sochi. He was sure the Sochi waters and climate had a restorative effect on him. It is possible that one reason he insisted on Tehran was that it would be a relief from snowbound Moscow. He left Moscow on the evening of November 22nd in a special train camouflaged to look like an ordinary supply train. The long saloon carriages in which his party traveled were interspersed between freight cars carrying sand and gravel. Stalin's carriage, a green armored bulletproof car that reputedly weighed 90 tons, consisted of his bedroom slash study, paneled in mahogany, with bed, desk, chair, and a mirror, a bathroom, 3 two-passenger bedrooms, a conference room, and a kitchen with an electric stove. The advisors he had chosen to bring with him to the conference numbered exactly 2, in startling contrast to the large numbers accompanying Roosevelt and Churchill. The first was Vyacheslav Molotov, the second most important man in the Soviet Union, with whom he could discuss strategy and policy. Molotov was his most intimate advisor, usually with him in the Kremlin for hours each day, the only person with whom he used the familiar ti, the equivalent of the French tu. Born Vyacheslav Mikhailovich Scriabin, following a practice common at the time, he adopted the name Molotov Hammer in Russian. People called him Stalin's Hammer.
Molotov had been at college in St. Petersburg when the revolution began. As order broke down, he became a bomb-making revolutionary. He'd been arrested by the Okhrana, the Tsar's secret police, almost as many times as Stalin. Molotov was deputy chairman of the State Defense Committee and Commissar of Foreign Affairs. Stalin relied on him, but not to the extent Roosevelt relied on Hopkins. Molotov did not have the authority that Hopkins did to speak for his boss. Stalin never hesitated to overrule Molotov. "I always agree with Marshal Stalin," said Molotov quickly to Eric Johnston, head of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, after Stalin overruled Molotov in Johnston's presence and said correspondents could visit the front. "Mr. Molotov always agrees with me," Stalin said with a slight grin. As Sir Stafford Cripps, Britain's ambassador to the Soviet Union in 1941, noted, Molotov wouldn't even offer an opinion if he had not discussed it beforehand with Stalin. "We had a very unenlightening talk, as always, as M. will not commit himself without consultation even on matters of opinion. It really isn't worth going to see him unless one sends a note beforehand so that he can get directions on it." Molotov and Stalin met putting out the first issues of the Bolshevik newspaper Pravda, Truth, in St. Petersburg in 1912. Stalin had been its first editor-in-chief. Molotov, only 22, upon meeting him, had been bowled over. "He's astonishing. He possesses internal revolutionary beauty, a Bolshevik to the marrow, clever, cunning as a conspirator," he told a friend. He never lost his awe. Molotov's Kremlin office was near Stalin's. His three-room apartment in the Kremlin was next door to Stalin's. Stocky, with dark brown hair, brown eyes, rimless round pince-nez, a moustache and a square face, he always dressed in a neat dark suit, white shirt, and dark tie. Like Stalin, he was short. He rarely smiled. He was a workaholic, with the reputation of being the Politburo's best filing clerk. George Kennan would write that he was the nearest thing known to a human machine. Churchill thought him Machiavellian because he had lived and thrived in a society where ever-varying intrigue was accompanied by the constant menace of personal liquidation. He was above all men fitted to be the agent and instrument of the policy of an incalculable machine. All agreed that he was reserved and hard-working. He spoke in a dull, stammering monotone, the stammer becoming more pronounced when Stalin was listening. Vladimir Pavlov, the interpreter Stalin most often used, preferred working for Stalin to Molotov. It was easier. Stalin valued people who understood the issues under discussion, but simultaneously were modest and did not try to distinguish themselves with their knowledge. More important, according to Pavlov, was that not only did Molotov seem to enjoy dressing down his associates, but when one was denounced by the NKVD, he never attempted to defend the person, always immediately agreeing to an arrest. Still, at Stalin's funeral, Molotov was the only pallbearer who cried. Communism was his religion as it was Stalin's. He had been in charge of the collectivization of the kulaks, Russian farmers who owned their land, who were offered a pittance for their crops. In protest, many resorted to burning their produce. "The kulaks are the most beastly, rude, and wild exploiters. More than once in the history of other countries, they have restored the power of the landowners, czars, and corrupt priests," Lenin had written. Molotov had carried out and justified their annihilation and that of other resisting Russian and Ukrainian farmers whom communist doctrine viewed as a capitalist class that had to be liquidated for the good of society. Once the farmers had been removed, they were replaced by party workers ignorant of farming techniques, which caused output to fall even more precipitously, putting even seed crops in short supply. The result of this experiment in social engineering had been the death from starvation of so many millions of Russians and Ukrainians that even Stalin had been appalled. "The collective farm policy was a terrible struggle. 10 millions. It was fearful. 4 years it lasted. 4 years Molotov oversaw it. It was absolutely necessary for Russia, if we were to avoid periodic famines, to plow the land with tractors," Stalin famously explained to Churchill. Collectivization finally did become more productive and dependable than traditional farming, but the toll had been huge. In only one thing was Molotov unusual and vulnerable: his wife, who was slender, fashionable, and Jewish. Polina Zemchuzhina, a lavish hostess before the war, had run the Soviet trust that manufactured and distributed cosmetics and toilet articles. Her job had been to show Russian women how to wear makeup. "My husband works on their souls, I on their faces," she once said. Just before he died, Stalin had Polina arrested and thrown in prison along with other Jews he suspected of Zionism. Molotov's position did not change. The second conference advisor he had brought with him was Marshal Clement E. Voroshilov, blonde, blue-eyed, a genial and swaggering ex-cavalryman who sported an elegant mustache. A hero of the Russian Civil War and president of the Council of People's Commissars, he had long been in Stalin's good graces. He had roomed with Stalin in Stockholm in 1906. But he was more friend than advisor. "A good fellow, but he is no military man," as Stalin described him. There was no question of his loyalty, and Stalin felt comfortable in his company. He was one of the few surviving original members of the Politburo, the tight group of 8 men and 5 alternates that ruled Russia. But he was no longer respected. Voroshilov had been Commissar of Defense when the Soviet Union invaded Finland in 1939. The Finns had acquitted themselves so brilliantly and the Red Army so miserably that he was removed from that post. After Hitler's invasion, Stalin made him Commander-in-Chief of the Northwestern Front, in charge of the defense of Leningrad. He was not up to that task either. At one point, believing the future of the city looked hopeless, he was on the verge of surrendering. Sure defeat was imminent. Stalin had replaced him with Georgi Zhukov, who immediately took the necessary heroic measures. Zhukov, a brilliant general, stripped the guns off the Russian warships in the Baltic and repositioned them to help defend the city, energized the starving inhabitants, deployed the city's defenses and resources, and finally saved Leningrad. The siege was lifted in January 1944. After Leningrad, Stalin cut the order, sending Comrade Voroshilov to do war work in the rear. He would be dropped from the State Defense Committee later in 1944. Voroshilov's saving grace was probably his especially good singing voice. In the late nights when Stalin was in his cups, he loved to unwind by singing with Voroshilov and Molotov, who not only had a good voice but played the violin, the mandolin, and the piano. The three had been harmonizing until the early hours of mornings for years. Molotov was as essential to Stalin as Hopkins was to Roosevelt, but Voroshilov was the loyal court jester. Also on the train was Lavrenty Beria, People's Commissar of Internal Affairs, better known as the head of the NKVD. He would take no part in the conference, but bore the responsibility for Stalin's personal security. Beria was an unsavory character. He was unattractive physically, somewhat plump, greenish-pale, and with soft, damp hands, was one description. Averill Harriman's daughter, Kathleen, wrote, "He was little and fat with thick lenses which give him a sinister look." Stalin's daughter, Svetlana Aleluyeva, loathed him, as had her mother. While her mother was alive, Beria was not allowed in their house. Also aboard the train were General Alexander Golovanov, the pilot who was to fly Stalin from Baku to Tehran, General Sergei Matveyevich Shtemyenko, later Director of Operations for the General Staff, whose job it was to keep Stalin informed of all battle news, and Stalin's physician, Professor Vinogradov. Churchill and Roosevelt would be bringing the best of their country's military staffs and civilian minds to Tehran. Except for Molotov, Stalin had left his in Russia. Stalin would explain this during the conference by saying that he had not expected military questions to be discussed, and therefore he had not brought his military experts with him. But nevertheless, Marshal Voroshilov would do his best. Except for the plenary sessions, which were large, formal affairs, he would often be missing. Fighter planes hovered over Stalin's train during the journey. 3 hours into the trip, having covered only 54 miles, the train stopped briefly at Golutvin station near the town of Ryazan, where 3 men were discovered sitting on the train's tender. They were apprehended, their identities were checked, and it was ascertained that they were common criminals hoping to hitch a ride in the darkness and had no knowledge of Stalin's presence. The train proceeded very slowly southward because there were constant problems. The rail equipment itself was in a terrible state, bearings kept melting down and the axle boxes burned. There was also the necessity of watching out for and repairing damaged rails as they crept through the devastated war-torn landscape. The train crew had great difficulty keeping to the schedule. As the train stopped at Gryaz near the city of Lipetsk, German bombers suddenly emerged in the night sky. Soviet fighter pilots waited at their planes, ready to scramble, and anti-aircraft squads stood by their guns waiting to fire as the bombers flew off into the distance. Communications aboard the train were a major problem. As well as breaks in the rails, there were breaks in the telegraph wires, the result of warm, wet weather suddenly freezing into glazed frost that broke the wires, so that the secret telephone communication lines, the Kremlivka lines, gave only spotty service after Rezan. As the train proceeded south and approached Stalingrad, now reduced to rubble, where the fighting had been so violent and the devastation so widespread that 500,000 Russians and 200,000 Germans died, the train lost all contact with headquarters. Beria was so enraged, he wanted to punish the guilty parties. The train arrived at Kilyazi station, 50 miles from Baku on the Caspian Sea, the morning of the 26th. Stalin and his group immediately left for the airport. There, four American C-47s waited to fly them the 335 miles to Tehran. Stalin started walking to the plane designated for him, next to which his pilot, General Golovanov, stood, but as he walked, he changed direction, turning toward Beria's plane. Beria's pilot was a colonel, and generals don't often pilot aircraft. We'd better go with the colonel, Stalin said, in explanation to Golovanov. Don't take it badly. It was a classic demonstration of Stalin's paranoia, that it was safer to go with the pilot who flew all the time, and safer also to change plans at the last moment to confound any possible conspirators. The route, an hour by plane from Baku to Tehran, was over the shore of the Caspian Sea, then over the brown expanse of Azerbaijan, then over Tabriz with its scattered little mud houses. But Stalin did not, like Roosevelt, accommodate himself to plane travel. It is doubtful if he even looked out the window at the passing landscape, although he undoubtedly checked out the three formations of fighters, one to the left, one to the right, one above, because the flight was bumpy and Stalin was seriously uncomfortable. The plane dropped periodically into air pockets, and when it did, he had clung to his armrests with an expression of utter terror on his face. Stalin arrived at Gallimorgi airfield at noon. Before exiting the plane, he chatted with the pilots. By way of thanks, he sent each of them the new style uniforms with epaulets marking their rank that he had ordered for the upper echelons of the Red Army earlier in the year. He wanted his Air Force pilots to look smart and well-dressed. Upon landing, he too would have seen the rows of P-39s that American Lend-Lease had given the Soviet Union, all sporting red stars. It is not known what kind of car awaited the marshal at the airport, but of the 10 cars reserved for his use in Tehran, 3 were American: a special armored Packard, a special armored Lincoln, and a special armored Cadillac. American technology was inescapable. Chapter 3. Tehran. Stretching from the foothills of the Alborz Mountains in the north to the edges of the Dasht-i-Kavir Desert in the south, Tehran was the largest city in the Middle East. The mountain range, with snow-capped Mount Damavand, the highest mountain in Iran at its center, dominated the view. From the air, the city looked as modern as a Western city, with broad paved avenues lined with trees. Mosques and minarets could be seen, and low white and brown buildings, many with green walled-in gardens. It had relatively modern hospitals, a university, museums, and a working telephone system. But Tehran was a study in contrasts. The streets were paved, but because the sidewalks were not, the air was dusty. The water supply was primitive. It came down from the mountains and ran in open streams alongside the principal streets. Because the streams were the city's sole water supply, people had no choice but to use the water for washing as well as drinking. Typhoid was rampant. Under the circumstances, the British, Russian, and U.S. embassies sent tank trucks up into the mountains to siphon water directly from mountain springs. Among the many precautions taken by the Russians during the conference was to change the procedure of accessing this water. Each day their tank trucks went up into the mountains to unannounced destinations. By 7 p.m. on Saturday, November 27th, Harriman and Molotov were working on the conference schedule. It is of particular note that implicit in this first meeting was the assumption that Roosevelt's wishes would be followed as to timing and discussion points. Harriman gave Molotov Roosevelt's plan for the first day. Stalin to call on him at 3 p.m., the first plenary session to commence at 4 p.m. Stalin, Molotov, Churchill, Eden, the British ambassador Archibald Clark Kerr, Hopkins, Harriman, plus the three interpreters to dine with him at 7:30 p.m. Harriman then relayed to Molotov FDR's conceptual outlook for the conference so that Stalin would be alerted. Roosevelt, said Harriman, had not come with Churchill with fixed ideas, but was prepared to lay before the marshal the various strategic plans. The principal question would be the influence of prompt action in the Mediterranean as against earlier or later overlord. Roosevelt's message was clear. The cross-channel invasion was now within Stalin's grasp if he faced down Churchill. Harriman and Molotov parted. Well past midnight, Harriman and Clark Kerr received calls from Molotov asking them to come over to the Russian embassy immediately. When they arrived, Molotov announced that Soviet sources had just learned that there were German agents in Tehran who knew of Roosevelt's presence. An assassination attempt was possible. The safest place for him under the circumstances was inside the Soviet compound. Driving through the city to visit each other was dangerous. Roosevelt, Molotov declared, should move. His story was plausible. Several years earlier, when the Iranian ruler had been Shah Riza, who was pro-fascist and a great admirer of Hitler's, there had been hundreds of German agents in Tehran, leading many to fear that Germany might assume control. To stop it from falling into Hitler's hands, the Soviet Union and Great Britain had jointly invaded Iran, forced the Shah to abdicate, and installed his 21-year-old son, Mohammad Reza Pahlavi, on the throne. In the two-year interim, however, known suspicious Germans had been deported. Molotov was firm on the necessity of Roosevelt's moving to the Soviet embassy and continued to maintain the existence of a possible German assassination plan as the rationale for the late invitation. Quite possibly Stalin, finally taking charge of the situation upon arrival at the embassy, had ordered Molotov to invite Roosevelt to move in even if the quarters were not finished. Possibly to give the story additional authority, General Artikov, Mike Riley's opposite number in the NKVD, later told Riley that 38 German parachutists had been dropped on the outskirts of Tehran a few weeks earlier, and that six were still at large. After Molotov declared that Roosevelt should move, late though it was, he took Harriman and Clark Kerr on a tour of the proposed presidential quarters, which were in the central building in the compound, next to the conference room that would be used for the plenary sessions. The tour provided at least a partial answer to the question of why Molotov was just now extending an invitation for the president to stay at the embassy. The apartment was still not finished. Although it was well past midnight, workmen were in the bathroom finishing the installation of the bathtub. In fact, the delay in asking Roosevelt to stay at the embassy had to have been caused by the delay in finishing the rooms. But it little mattered whether the danger was real or imagined. Danger cleared the air for all concerned. Roosevelt was free to accept, not even his severest critics, the rabid right wing in America who thought he was a communist sympathizer, would be able to fault his choice of residence. The following morning, obviously delighted at the prospect, FDR announced he would move at 2:30 p.m. and that the U.S. Navy Filipino mess crew who cooked for him at Shangri-La, whom he had brought, would prepare his meals. As all foodstuffs consumed by the U.S. forces were shipped in and nothing bought locally, the supply of food for the presidential party was not a problem. Riley, taking no chances, mindful of the NKVD report and the president's safety, laid on protective measures for the president's move to the embassy, which would be by limousine. Early in the afternoon, he assembled a motorcade, with armed jeeps at the head and rear, stationed Secret Service men armed with Tommy guns on the running boards of the president's car, and lined the streets of the route with U.S. soldiers standing shoulder to shoulder. As the motorcade moved slowly, majestically, past, the Iranians cheered. But inside the car sat a Secret Service agent posing as Roosevelt. After the motorcade was on its way, Riley whisked FDR, Leahy, and Hopkins into an inconspicuous car. The car, preceded by a jeep, then went through back streets to the Russian embassy at a brisk pace, arriving before the motorcade. "The boss, as always, was vastly amused by the dummy cavalcade trip," Riley remembered. Chief of Staff Leahy and, of course, Hopkins moved in with the president. Stalin stayed in one of the smaller houses in the park-like Russian compound. Molotov and Voroshilov stayed in yet another. In moving into the embassy, Roosevelt would have been well aware that his rooms would be bugged by the Russians, that every word he said, every word said to him, would be overheard. But U.S. government personnel and Roosevelt himself had assumed for years that every important building, hotel, and embassy in the Soviet Union was bugged. In 1934, Roosevelt had sent William Bullitt, America's first ambassador to the Soviet Union, with the following advice. "You will, of course, warn all the members of the staff of both embassy and consulate in Russia that they will be spied upon constantly." In 1936, a man was discovered in the attic of Spassow House, the ambassador's residence in Moscow, dangling a microphone over a spot roughly above Ambassador Joseph E. Davies' desk. The film Mission to Moscow, which Davies had brought to Moscow in the spring of 1943 and shown to Stalin and the assembled Politburo, had in it a scene making fun of the ubiquitous bugging of diplomats by the Soviet government. Roosevelt would have assumed that everything he and his staff said was reported to Stalin, and he would have adjusted all conversation accordingly, even though there was no bugging equipment visible. Indeed, the microphones were so state-of-the-art small, the NKVD's head, Lavrenty Beria, boasted that it was impossible to spot them. Being such a good actor, the president probably enjoyed exercising his talents. Stalin set great store in listening to the taped conversations. According to Beria, who briefed Stalin each morning at 8 as to what he had heard in the president's quarters, Stalin even went so far as to ask for details of the tone of the conversations. Did he say that with conviction or without enthusiasm? How did Roosevelt react? Did he say that resolutely? What do you think? Do they know we are listening? Roosevelt always expressed a high opinion of Stalin. Stalin once remarked, seemingly puzzled, "They know that we can hear them, and yet they speak openly. It's bizarre. They say everything in fullest detail." I was able to establish from my eavesdropping that Roosevelt felt great respect and sympathy for Beria. Admiral Leahy tried several times to persuade him to be firmer with Beria. Every time he received the reply from Roosevelt, "That doesn't matter. Do you think you can see further than I can? I am pursuing this policy because I think it is more advantageous. We are not going to pull the chestnuts out of the fire for the British." Nothing underlines Stalin's obsessive and thorough nature quite as clearly as his daily analysis of Roosevelt's supposedly private words and attitudes. Nothing underlines Roosevelt's ability to size people up correctly and his talents as an actor more than his pursuit of the invitation to stay in the Russian embassy and his conduct while there. Stalin learned only what Roosevelt wanted him to learn. Roosevelt would have been tickled pink to know that Stalin didn't dream Roosevelt knew his conversations were being picked up by hidden microphones. Roosevelt's living arrangements brought out paranoia in the British. "Plainly, it is convenient to him, Stalin, to have the president under his eye where he cannot spend his time plotting with the British prime minister," observed Churchill's doctor, Lord Moran, voicing the general underestimation of Roosevelt's intelligence that was endemic among the British at the conference. Intimidatingly fit members of the NKVD, wearing pistols, took the place of servants in the president's rooms. One look at the men who made their beds and cleaned their rooms made this clear. Remembered Riley, "Everywhere you went you would see a brute of a man in a lackey's white coat busily polishing immaculate glass or dusting dustless furniture. As their arms swung to dust or polish, the clear, cold outline of a Luger automatic could be seen on every hip." Commander William Rigdon, assistant naval aide, left to wind up things after the presidential party had left, was startled to see that a number of the servants, shedding their white coats, were in reality Russian officers with uniforms and insignia indicating ranks up to general. Brute Soviet soldiers were, in fact, everywhere. 200 soldiers armed with submachine guns ringed the embassy grounds. More soldiers, all of them really big men, nothing under 6 feet two, ringed Roosevelt's particular building. There seemed to be a Soviet guard behind every tree in the park as well. The street between the Russian and the British embassies was turned into a passage by the placement of high walls from embassy to embassy. The Russian embassy park itself was surrounded by a stone wall, and each morning Lavrenty Beria, the collar of his overcoat turned up, his felt hat pulled down over his eyes, cruised the embassy park in a Buick with darkly tinted windows. The president probably never felt safer. Discussing the living arrangements later, Roosevelt always left out that he had asked Stalin's advice as to where he should stay. He told Francis Perkins a half-truth that at no time did he believe there had been any plot. But he also told her that it was clear to him that Stalin wanted him at the Russian embassy, and, he went on, embroidering his story, the move distressed him because, to make it possible, Stalin had to move out to a small cottage on the embassy grounds. No one, with the single exception of Hopkins, knew about Roosevelt's original query to Stalin, asking where he should live, until years later, when their full correspondence was published. Churchill would have been stunned if he had known. But Stalin knew, and Molotov, and that was the whole point. Roosevelt wanted Stalin to see the lengths he had gone to lay the groundwork for their meeting. It was a small thing to do to please them. If we could woo them in this way, perhaps it was the cheapest thing we could do. It was a matter of exhibiting my trust in them, my complete confidence in them. And it did please them, no question about it, he said later to Perkins. Roosevelt did it because he wanted Stalin to sign on to a full political agenda. There were the military considerations. He had to set a firm date for Overlord, the Allied invasion, the Second Front, as the Russians called it. And although Stalin had told Cordell Hull in Moscow in October that the Soviet Union would join America in the war against Japan, Roosevelt needed to hear such a commitment from Stalin's lips. Soviet military plans had to be coordinated with Overlord. But what was of supreme importance to Roosevelt was the endgame, the structure of the peace, and for that he needed Stalin's full cooperation. Versailles, the horror and futility of that post-war peace conference, was always on his mind. Only at a conference of the victors, held while still fighting shoulder to shoulder, still in need of each other, did he feel he could shape the post-war world. How many times did Roosevelt suggest a meeting to Stalin? Countless. By spring 1943, no nearer a meeting, FDR was beginning to feel really anxious. The tide of war was changing in favor of the Allies, and he still had no meeting scheduled. He decided to try new tactics. He proposed a meeting without Churchill because, as he told the Canadian Prime Minister Mackenzie King, with whom he had been friends since Harvard, who was visiting the White House, "I have a hunch that Stalin does not want to see the two of us together, at least at the outset, and that he would like to talk with me alone." FDR envisioned this meeting as taking place in Alaska, possibly in Nome, in August. He had it all worked out in his mind. He would meet up with Mackenzie King in Ottawa. The two of them would drive north on the Alcan Highway. FDR had ordered its construction in 1942. The Army Corps of Engineers had finished it against all odds 8 months later. He was dying to see it. Then he would continue alone to Alaska to meet Stalin. King, who knew Churchill at least as well as FDR did, told FDR he foresaw no objection from the Prime Minister because Churchill had been in Russia and seen Stalin there. But King was wrong. Churchill minded a great deal, and Roosevelt would later in June deny to Churchill that he had written to Stalin asking him for a private meeting. "It had been Stalin's idea," Roosevelt wrote. "I did not suggest to UJ that we meet alone, but he told Davies that he assumed, A, that we would meet alone, and B, that he agreed that we should not bring staffs to what would be a preliminary meeting." To underline the importance of a meeting of just the two of them to Stalin, the president had Joseph E. Davies deliver his message in person. Davies, his good friend, who had established a good relationship with Stalin when he had been American ambassador to the Soviet Union from 1936 to 1938, arrived in Moscow in late May 1943. In his letter, Roosevelt demonstrated his fine geographic knowledge. "My dear Mr. Stalin, I am sending this personal note to you by the hands of my old friend. It relates solely to one subject, which I think it is easier for us to talk over through a mutual friend. I want to get away from the difficulties of large staff conferences. Africa is almost out of the question in summer, and Khartoum is British territory. Iceland I do not like because for both you and me it involves rather difficult flights, and in addition would make it, quite frankly, difficult not to invite Prime Minister Churchill at the same time. Therefore, I suggest we meet either on your side or our side of the Bering Straits." Roosevelt hoped to cut through Stalin's anger and disappointment at the lack of concrete plans for the Second Front, which he had led Molotov to believe was going to happen that summer. Stalin accorded Davies a special welcome when he arrived in Moscow in 1943. He met with him for 2.5 hours on May 20th, and 3 days later threw him a formal dinner in the Kremlin. Virtually all of the Politburo were at the dinner, at the conclusion of which Mission to Moscow was shown. The movie, produced by Warner Brothers, based on Davies' book of the same title, was essentially a Hollywood propaganda film designed to whip up sympathy for the hard-pressed Russians. It purported to give the facts as I, Ambassador Davies, saw them. The all-star cast featured Walter Huston, Roosevelt's favorite of favorites actor, as Davies, Anne Harding as his wife, Marjorie Merriweather Post-Davies, and Oscar Homolka as Maxim Litvinov. Other actors played Joseph Stalin, Winston Churchill, and the British Foreign Secretary Anthony Eden. The film was a great paean to Soviet courage, to Soviet grit, and to the heroic struggle by Soviet civilians and soldiers against the onslaught of the German army. The movie suggested that Soviet workers who fulfilled their factory quotas and were rewarded with extra rubles had a great deal in common with American workers. Collective farms were depicted as producing mountains of food. There were dramatic photographs of sabotaged Russian factories being blown up as justification for the Moscow show trials of 1936 to 38. That was followed by a dramatization of a show trial during which high Soviet officials confessed to taking orders from the traitor Leon Trotsky, who, aided by the German government, was seeking to overthrow the Soviet government. The movie couldn't have been more laudatory to the Soviet cause if it had been directed by the Kremlin. When it was over, after the lights were turned on, after the clapping, everyone turned to see Stalin's reaction. He looked quite stunned, remembered a British diplomat, who reported that at length he said, "Let's all get a drink." Pleasantly amazed, as he must have been, by the enthusiastic, simplistic portrayal, he decreed that it could be shown all over the Soviet Union. It pleased him so much that in later years it became one of the films he most enjoyed watching. Davies thought Stalin had agreed to a meeting with FDR. "As to the particular mission I was engaged upon, I believe that the result thereof has been completely successful," he advised Roosevelt. Stalin cabled FDR that he thought they could meet in July or August, saying he would give the president 2 weeks prior notice of the exact date. "I agree with you that such a meeting is necessary and that it should not be postponed." But he also warned that the summer months will be extremely serious for our Soviet armies. Unusually, this message closed with Stalin's writing, "With sincere respect." Then, on June 11, 1943, Stalin wrote to Roosevelt to tell him of his disappointment in learning that at the Trident Conference, just concluded in Washington, "you and Mr. Churchill made the decision postponing the British-American invasion of Western Europe until spring of 1944. This decision creates exceptional difficulties for the Soviet Union." Roosevelt did not directly respond to this. Instead, he wrote that he was stepping up the shipments of aluminum that the Soviet Union so desperately needed and, "in addition to our new protocol agreement, I have directed that 600 additional fighters be sent to you during the balance of 1943, the most maneuverable fighter we have.
I have also directed the shipment of 78 additional B-25s. Stalin sent another angry message regarding the postponement of the invasion to the president on June 24th in the form of relaying the message he had sent to Churchill. "You write to me that you fully understand my disappointment. I have to tell you that this is not simply a matter of disappointment of the Soviet government, but a matter of preservation of its confidence in the Allies, which confidence is subjected to hard trials. One must not forget that it is a question of preservation of millions of lives in occupied regions of Western Europe and Russia, and reduction of the tremendous sacrifices of the Soviet armies in comparison with which the sacrifices of the Anglo-American forces constitute a small quantity." 2 days later, however, certainly influenced by a laudatory message Roosevelt sent him on the second anniversary of Hitler's invasion of the Soviet Union, which took 2 days to get to him, in which the president mentioned the act of treachery, the history-making exploits of the armed forces of the Soviet Union, the almost incredible sacrifices which the Russian people are so heroically making, and approaching the challenging tasks of peace which victory will present to the world, Stalin sent the president a friendly message that expressed his mindset at the time, ascertainable because, unusually, he took the trouble to cross out the original Vryevsky as describing the Germans and replace it with Zadvernik, which translates as brigands. "I thank you for the high evaluation of the determination and courage of the Soviet people and of their armed forces in their struggle against the German brigands. As a result of the 2 years' struggle of the Soviet Union against Hitlerite Germany and her vassals, and as a result of the serious blows which have been delivered by the Allies to the Italian-German armies in North Africa, the conditions for the final destruction of our common enemy have been created." In July, Roosevelt impatiently reminded Stalin that he was still waiting for a firm meeting date. But the German counterattack that Stalin had been waiting for had finally begun. Hitler had amassed huge numbers of tanks and guns in preparation for a battle at Kursk, southwest of Moscow, counting on the German armies winning a decisive victory there that would fire up the world. The battle involved 4,000 planes, 6,000 tanks, and more than 2 million soldiers. The Red Army fought the Germans to a standstill, then gradually pushed them back and overwhelmed them. By the fifth day, the battle was finished. The Red Army was in control. It was a decisive time, the end of Hitler's penetration of the Soviet Union. Almost immediately, the Red Army regrouped and began marching, quickly retaking Aryol and Belgorod, then advancing in force toward the Dnieper River and beyond. On August 8th, Stalin finally responded to Roosevelt's message. He explained that he couldn't take a long journey. "The battles are in full swing. The Soviet armies repelled the July offensive, recaptured Aryol and Belgorod, and now is putting the further pressure upon the enemy. I shall not be able, unfortunately, during this summer and autumn, to keep my promise given to you through Mr. Davies." "Unless," he continued, "Roosevelt came all the way to him. Under the present military situation, it could be arranged either in Astrakhan or in Archangel." As to Roosevelt's suggestion that they meet à deux, Stalin seemed to think it was a trick. "I do not have any objections to the presence of Mr. Churchill at this meeting, hoping you will not have any objections to this." Although there was no way for Roosevelt to know it, Stalin had taken great care with this message. It is one of the few written in his own hand. Roosevelt took this as a cue that Stalin wanted Churchill present, and his next two cables asking for a meeting were co-signed by Churchill. He followed these up with another on September 4th, mentioning Churchill as the third conferee. "I personally could arrange to meet in a place as far as North Africa." Finally, on September 8th, Stalin agreed he could now take the time to meet, but he dismissed North Africa as a location. He would only travel as far as Iran. Roosevelt didn't want to go there with good reason. As he wrote to Stalin on October 14th, Tehran presented a problem because the U.S. Constitution stipulated that
new laws and resolutions must be acted on by me after their receipt and must be returned to Congress physically before 10 days have elapsed. The possibility of delay in getting over the mountain, first eastbound and then westbound, is insurmountable." Stalin replied, "Unfortunately, not one of the places proposed instead of Tehran by you for the meeting is suitable for me." The end of October found Roosevelt as upset as he ever got because of Stalin's insistence on Tehran. In a long, impassioned message, he pulled out all the stops, writing, "I would gladly go 10 times the distance to meet you were it not for the fact that I must carry on a constitutional government more than 150 years old. It would be regarded as a tragedy by future generations if you and I and Mr. Churchill failed today because of a few 100 miles. I repeat that I would gladly go to Tehran were I not prevented from doing so because of limitations over which I have no control. Please do not fail me in this crisis." His message was timed so that Hull, in Moscow, for the Conference of Foreign Ministers, could personally deliver it to Stalin. The strain of not knowing and keeping up appearances was telling on the president. He came down with the flu on October 19th, running a temperature that went as high as 104 degrees for days. On October 25th, Hull, accompanied by Harriman, met with Stalin in the Kremlin.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.